Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Let's pray. Almighty and merciful God, as we gather in this virtual sacred space, we humbly bow before your throne of grace. In this moment of reflection, we pour out our hearts in confessing, laying bare the frailties that separate us from your perfect holiness, Lord. We confess our shortcomings, the moments when we have faltered and strayed away from your divine path. Grant us the strength to repent, to turn our hearts back to you, Lord, and to embrace the transformative power of your forgiveness. In adoration, Lord, we lift our voices in awe and wonder at the magnificence of your being. You are the creator of the universe, the Alpha and the Omega, the source of all life, Lord. Your love, boundless and unchanging, fills our heart with reverence. in the quietude of this moment, help us to reflect on your majesty, acknowledging that you alone are worthy of all our praise. As we enter into the spirit of thanksgiving, we recognize the abundance of your blessings in our lives, for the gift of life, the warmth of relationships, and the daily provisions that sustain us. We are truly grateful, Lord. Thank you for the grace that sustains us, the mercy that redeems us, and the love that surrounds us. Open our eyes to the countless ways your goodness unfolds each day. In this sacred space of daily devotion, Lord, may your presence envelop us, illuminate our mind with your wisdom, and soften our heart with your compassion, and guide our steps with your truth. As we embark on this journey of spiritual reflection, may the fruit of confession, adoration, and thanksgiving deepen our connection with you and with one another. We say thank you, Lord. We offer this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen.
All glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom authority flows from his throne unto his own, his anthem raised. Worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom authority flows from his throne unto his own. Died, now glorified, King of all kings. Majesty, majesty, worship his majesty, majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Oh, Majesty,
Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Our scripture reading is taken from the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 25, verse 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did to one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You who are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And this will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the gospel of Christ.
Thank you. Please be seated. Rejoice, the Lord is King. I am so very delighted to be here with you this morning in this place of worship, and spent some time in Barbados because I was at Erdiston Teachers Training College. It's where I met my lovely wife, Romania. And of course, we spent some time at Cahill. As you know, Blundell is Romania's sister, and so is Ingrid. And my sister Glendora is here. And our children are here. Keisha and Jeremy's outside, and Dion and his lovely wife, Jada. So I'm happy to be here at such a momentous occasion in Jada and Dion's life. But as we have been singing, you may have noticed that much of our worship was about Christ the King. And today, in churches that consider themselves liturgical congregations who follow the liturgical calendar, today is celebrated as Christ the King Sunday. And so, as you heard earlier, the liturgical year actually begins with Advent. So next Sunday is our new year, so to speak. In Advent, and Epiphany, then Lent, and Easter, and Pentecost, and comes around to this crowning moment, the last Sunday of the liturgical calendar, Christ the King Sunday. If you remember the hymns we sung this morning, they went to that very theme, beginning with, O worship the King, and then all hail King Jesus and majesty, and now rejoice, the Lord is King. And so I have chosen to entitle my sermon, Let's Give Them Something to Think About. Shall we pray? Gracious, loving, merciful Creator God, we bless and praise you for this day and for this time, for this gathering and for all that it represents in our lives, a time to commune with you and to hear from you. So I pray, O God, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock, you are our strength, and you are our Redeemer. It is in the name of Jesus the Christ that we pray, and for his sake. Amen. I want you to travel with me back to the first century, where early Christians are huddled together in homes, awaiting updates and reports about other Christians who had been thrown into prison, or those who had been beaten, or those who had been killed because they were willing to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. This was the church's earliest proclamation and confession. And it was radical and countercultural because it was saying, it is not Caesar who is Lord. It is not the emperor who is Lord. It is Jesus Christ who is Lord. And so they huddled together in homes and met for worship, not in sanctuaries and edifices like we have today, but in homes of fellow Christians. And as they gather, it is possible that one in their midst got up and say, we have a letter here from our brother Paul, who is in prison. And some who have studied this letter to the Philippians tell us that embedded within this letter is what may be called an early Christian hymn, which we find in Philippians chapter 2. The hymn offers praise to Christ, the one who engages in kenosis, a Greek term for self-emptying. That is to say, the pre-existent Christ, the one who was in the very beginning, before all time, the one who was in creation and by whom all things were made, according to John's Gospel, chapter 1 and verse 1. The pre-existent Christ, he emptied himself of all of his divinity, humbled himself, and took on human form. Think about that. And so the hymn claims that for this reason, meaning what Christ has undertaken, to empty himself of his divinity and to humble himself and to take on human form and to be obedient even to death, his death on the cross. For this reason, God has highly exalted Jesus and given him a name that is above every other name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Jesus Christ is Lord. That was their confession then. And today, as we celebrate Christ the King Sunday, we are also adding to that confession, Jesus Christ is King. Oh, worship the King, all glorious above. All hail King Jesus. Sing with the King who is coming to reign. Then the apostle, the one who had often been stoned or beaten or thrown into prison, he writes to this congregation in Philippi and says to them, as they huddle together in fear of what may happen to them, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. And today the hymn writer adds to that, takes those words and writes, rejoice, the Lord is King. And in case you didn't hear it, let's present the parallel to that. Your Lord and King, adore, rejoice, the Lord is King. Your Lord and King, adore. And so these early Christians stood against the Roman Empire and proclaimed that rather than Caesar, rather than the emperor, it was Jesus Christ who was Lord. A radical thing to say, a radical position to take. But yet they understood that the lordship of Jesus was not a call to dominance or Christian triumphalism, or a call to force or to coerce other people to be Christians. It was a call to the life of humility, modeled after our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. A life of self-emptying, a life of love, a life of obedience, even unto death. Unfortunately, my brothers and sisters, I have to share with you this morning that the church has too often forgotten about the Christ who humbled himself. Instead, the church has too often thought that it has a mandate to make every knee bow and every tongue confess. And this, my friends, you know very well, is the attitude that gave rise to the Crusades, a very embarrassing period and an awful blot in the history of Christianity. Because instead of humility, the church has given its blessing to the narrative of conquest that led for centuries to the rape and pillaging of Africa, or to the conquest of the New World and exploitation of South America. Instead of humility, the church has given its blessing and sanctioned the decimation of the indigenous peoples of the world, whether from Australia to North America and around the world. Instead of humility, the church has given its blessing to the trade, to the slave trade. Instead of humility, the church has given its blessing to systems of segregation, as you will find in the as we found in the United States of America, and apartheid in South Africa. Instead of humility, the church has stood in support of every war and every act of aggression from the United States and from countries that we love and support. Instead of humility, the church has preached a gospel of second-class status for women and tacit support for male dominance that turns a blind eye to domestic violence, to rape and abuse of women and children. Instead of humility, the church has contributed to the denigration of our brothers and sisters based on their gender or their sexuality. We have forgotten that God does not repudiate or denigrate God's own creation, and neither should we. We shouldn't denigrate, we shouldn't discriminate on the basis of one's country of origin or a person's religion or a person's ethnicity, or a person's language, or their abilities, mental or physical. And so you said to me, preacher, in light of all that you have said, and in midst of our understanding of all the chaos in the world today, and the violence and the warfare in Ukraine and in the Middle East with Israel and the Palestinians, in a world of division, a world of strife, a world of bigotry, a world that devalues human life, what should we do? What, as Christians, should we do? What, as a church of Jesus Christ, should we do? Well, I think this letter to the Philippians offers a word for those of us who have become too arrogant, too comfortable, too affluent to look out for the interests of others. For those of us who have become too warm to hear the cries of those who are out in the cold with no place to sleep. For those of us who have become too indifferent to the cries of those who are displaced by violence or poverty or warfare. Today's letter to the Philippians provides us with a way forward. The word for the church, the word for every Christian today, is found in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8. And it's something to think about. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Something to think about. And the church is called to give the world something to think about. Amen? Let's give them something to think about. I think this passage of scripture is one of those passages that I learned on my mother's knee. It is probably one of those passages of scripture that I learned and was reinforced by my Sunday school teachers. And I believe they were trying to tell me, listen, listen to the singing that is coming from behind the prison walls, where those are imprisoned who suffer for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think they were trying to tell me, listen to the testimony of those who have experienced violence and hardship in their lives, and even imprisonment. I think they were trying to tell me, listen, Lincoln, and you might learn something. Listen, and you will have in your spirit something to think about. Oh, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. And I said to you this morning, Hawthorne, the church must not only think, but it must also speak, and it must commit to whatever is true. And that is how the church will function in the world, because it will be able as a church to speak truth to power. The church must not only think, but it must also speak, and it must commit to whatever is just, because that's the only way that the church will be committed to a ministry of justice in the world. And so I think what we find here in the letter to the Philippians is a call to remember the one who emptied himself of his divinity and who comes now to us in this time and in this place in human flesh. Think about that. As we in turn in our time have an opportunity to remember that a cup of water given in his name, in Jesus' name, is its own reward. Think about it. The Jesus who comes to us to dwell among us, as we will celebrate next Sunday and the season of Advent, the season of Incarnation and Christmas. The one who comes to dwell among us, to be with us in human form. And he comes as one who is hungry and thirsty and naked and in prison. And he says, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers or my sisters, you did it unto me. In the war-torn village somewhere in this world, he, our Lord and Savior Jesus, is the child whose leg is blown off by a landmine. In our communities, he is the battered woman, and he says to us, inasmuch as you did it to the least of these, my brothers and my sisters. In our communities today, he is the AIDS patient, and he says to us, inasmuch as you did it to the least of our brothers and sisters. He is the homeless seeking shelter. He is the child abandoned by her parents and left to fend for herself among predators and death-dealing drug pushers and pimps. And he says to us as the church, as we consider our ministries in the world, inasmuch as you did it to the least of one of these, my brothers and my sisters, you did it unto me. The good news found in Paul's letter today seems to be a very simple message and yet so profound. and yet so consequential. It's a pleasure to be worshiping here this morning with your bishop. And perhaps it's easier just to look at Bishop this morning instead of thinking about Paul of 2,000 years ago. Look at Bishop this morning in the same position as the Apostle Paul. He oversees the church. He carries the weight of the church on his shoulders. And you have, as a church, huddled together and you have prayed for Bishop. And he writes a letter to the church out of conference, and it begins. You can feel the pathos and the emotion. The words in chapter 4, verse 1. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, stand firm in the Lord. In this way, my beloved, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I will say, rejoice. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
Because you see, the message for the church this morning, whether from Paul or from the bishop, the message for the church today is simple, but it's radical, because it demands your life, your commitment, your all. Because when we declare the lordship of Christ, when we declare that that Christ is King, we are also declaring our commitment to a life of obedience and humility. Rejoice. We are committing ourselves to giving the world something to think about in our speech and in our actions. We are saying to the world that although we have come through many challenges, we rejoice in the Lord. In spite of all that we have overcome, through all the hardships that we have encountered, through all the obstacles that we have surmounted, through all the battles that we have won, through all the storms that we have weathered, through all the demons that we have fought, through all the conflicts that we have endured, we've got a message to tell to the world, and we've got something to think about, something to talk about, something to shout about. How about this, my beloved? Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Oh, this day it is my prayer for you here at Hawthorne, that God may strengthen your hearts, that we may not only think about these things, but that we may also live and witness to whatever is true and honorable and just and pure and pleasing and commendable, and that we will think about these things. Oh, may God grant you this morning to so confirm our testimony and our witness that we may go into the world and into our workplaces and into our homes with the instructions of our bishop and the instructions of the Apostle Paul bubbling up in our spirits. If there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Rejoice in the Lord, brothers and sisters. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice to the glory of God, our Creator. Amen and amen. Now, as we've listened to the word, and we are reminded that when we gather in this place to recharge our spiritual batteries, That is, that this is not only a time for us to look inwards as we recharge for the week that is ahead, but also a time to look outwards and to remember those who are out in the world, some who cannot even pray for themselves this morning, whatever their conditions might be. And so we go to the Lord in prayer to lift up the world before Christ the King. Shall we pray? Gracious God, we pray for all those who are in authority, for all of the Caesars and the emperors of this world, for those who are given responsibility for the temporal affairs of this world, that they may look beyond themselves to treasure those things that are true and just. We pray that they may lead their people with a commitment to righteousness, to compassion, and to the inclusion of all of your creation. We pray for those who are living today in war-torn countries such as Ukraine and the conflict in the Middle East, particularly between Israel and the Palestinians, a conflict that has lasted now for about 75 years with no end in sight, that they may hear the good news of the gospel, the one whom we celebrate, Christmas, that they may hear of peace. And as we get into this season of Christmas, that they may hear the message of the church, let there be peace on earth, peace and goodwill among all peoples. We pray for those who are behind prison bars this morning and for those who are in hospitals, for those who are waiting for medical attention and surgical care, for those who are lonely and out of their minds and are unable even to recognize their surroundings and their loved ones. That it may please you to visit with them wherever they may be this morning, and grant them your grace and the compassion of your presence and your healing spirit. We pray for our church and for all the churches of the world, that they may indeed stand up and witness to the one who we celebrate as King and as Lord. We pray for our bishop and for his task as the overseer of all of our churches in the South District. This district, we thank you for his witness that goes beyond this district to the world at large. We bless you for all those who minister alongside it, or the pastors, preachers, for all those who exercise leadership in our churches, and particularly those who year in and year out offer ministry, ministry of music, ministry of service, ministry of prayer and care, that they may not lose heart, that they may continue to look to the one who gives them strength and the one who has called them and who gives them a word of encouragement this morning to rejoice through it all. We pray for our children as we think about the next generation and the legacy that we will leave behind. May we, like Paul, be able to say, I have run a good race, I have kept the faith. And may we find joy in the glimpses of what the next generation might be like as we look at the talents, the gifts, the graces, the leadership, and the service of our young people today. May it bless our hearts to know that they too are committed to your service. And so, loving Lord, we pray that you might accept the prayers that we offer to your divine majesty,
For we offer them in the name of Jesus the Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, God in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen.
Jesus.
Thank you for being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word and may it dwell in all of us richly.